This is traditional Turkish coffee brewed in a sand pit. Believe it or not, this century-old tradition holds the key to solving one of renewable energy's worst pitfalls, its intermittency. How? The secret is in the hot sand. I'm talking about sand batteries, a scalable and very different approach to store excess energy from wind and solar that uses one of the cheapest, most ubiquitous and abundant raw materials you can think of, sand. How does it work and how can it give lithium-ion batteries a run for their money? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky and this is Two for the Vinci. So you might be thinking, storing power in sand doesn't exactly sound intuitive, does it? But hear me out. A sand battery is a very simple form of thermal energy storage, and it stores energy in the form of heat. Think of a sand battery as a giant thermos filled with hot sand. We take the excess energy from solar, wind, or even the grid when energy is cheap and use it to heat up a whole bunch of sand. And I mean a lot of sand. Fundamentally, there's two ways to store energy. Store that heat at a higher temperature or in more sand, or both. And if you do both, you can store a ton of energy. We'll get to numbers here in a minute, but for now, let's focus on how it works. Now, sand might not seem that special, but it rocks at holding in the heat. Think of those evenings when the beach sand is toasty long after the sun has gone down. That's what we're harnessing. We use the stored energy either directly as heat or convert it back to electricity. The last part is a bit tricky and has several cons, which we'll explore in a minute. But using heat directly is the easiest thing in the world. We've been doing it for centuries. Remember that Turkish coffee I showed you earlier? The process starts by heating a tray of sand called sezv and then using that heat from the sand to brew the coffee, extracting the heat directly. So the sezv is essentially the grandfather of sand batteries, dating all the way back to the 15th or 16th century. But why do we need sand batteries or any other type in the first place? Well, because renewable energies of the future might be intermittent. The sun doesn't shine exactly the same throughout the day, and it doesn't shine at night, and the wind doesn't blow at the same speed either. In fact, if you saw our video on how wind farms have a dirty little secret, you'll remember that even when the wind is blowing, wind farms sometimes have to shut down because of a lack of demand. This gets complicated, and this is why we need some sort of place to put energy when we don't need it right away. So the only way then to power our lives 24/7 with renewable energy is to take full advantage of peak generation and store it when it's not needed for times when it is. I remember hearing about sand batteries when a Finnish company called Polar Night Energy unveiled the world's first commercial sand battery. It was all the rage a couple of years ago. They built a pilot plant, a large industrial-sized battery with a capacity of 8 megawatt hours, delivering 200 kilowatts of power as heat, enough to provide district heating for 100 homes during the cold Finnish winters. That battery has been in operation since 2022 in the Finnish city of Kankanpa. If I'm saying that wrong, I apologize. And it uses 100 tons of low-grade construction sand heated to around 1100 degrees Celsius. So how exactly does the battery work? It's pretty simple. You start with a huge insulated thermos, put some pipes similar to a radiator, and fill it with sand or similar material. When there's excess energy, we use that energy to power an electrical resistive heating coil like the ones you would find in a water heater. That heats air, which runs through a closed loop system of pipes that heat the sand to up to 1100 degrees Fahrenheit, storing electrical energy as heat. To use the energy, we have several options. We can use it as heat by warming up water in a separate closed loop system like a district heating system, or like we do with a geothermal heat pump. Or we can convert the heat back into electricity and use it to power our lives. But which is better? By far, it's better to use the heat directly. Turning electricity into heat is easy and has a very high efficiency of about 100%. But turning heat into electricity makes you lose 30 to 50% of the energy you put in. So these batteries are best to store and use heat directly. So not to power your iPads and charge your cars, but to heat your homes or your water. Of all the tech we cover, energy storage is near and dear to me because it's something that we can actually invest in today. And if you're thinking about batteries, solar, heat pumps, or EV chargers, our sponsor, Energy Sage, has your back. They're a long-term partner of the channel, and Energy Sage has helped many of our viewers and over 1 million homeowners find a solar installer. And everything on Energy Sage is free, from educational content to solar savings calculators, all the way to real quotes from trusted installers. Homeowners who use Energy Sage on average save around 20% on their solar system costs compared to going direct to an installer, and it makes it easy to compare quotes side by side. So ditch the high pressure salespeople, by far the worst part about going solar, and instead have a trusted advocate on your side with Energy Sage. So whether you're curious and want to learn or actually are ready to shop, check out Energy Sage for your energy journey. Use my special link in the description and get started today. Huge thanks to Energy Sage and you. Now back to the show. So if you're not powering our lives, our refrigerators and our TVs, but only heating our homes, how valuable would that actually be? And it turns out quite a bit. According to the Energy Information Administration, only 30% of the total energy that we use every day goes to things like lighting, refrigeration, and powering our electronics. 9% goes to air conditioning, and nearly 60%, that's almost 2/3 of all the energy that we use at home, goes to space or water heating. Now that really surprised me. And of course, we're talking about the total share of energy, not just electricity. When we narrow it down to just electricity, 19% goes to AC and 24% goes to space and water heating. Okay, so heat, really important. We can store directly, forget electricity, just use it as heat. But why sand? I know some huge thermal storage systems just heat up water, and others use special types of bricks. So why not use those instead or something else? Sand is incredibly abundant and cheap. Scientists estimate there are roughly 7.5 sextillion grains of sand on Earth. And that is an astronomical number. That's 75 followed by 20 zeros. But sand isn't just widely abundant. It has some really killer thermal properties. Check out this table where we compare dry sand with other materials. Sand can absorb and retain significant amounts of heat, almost 1,000 joules per kilogram per every degree Celsius we heat it. That's less than a quarter of what you could store with the same amount of water. But there's a catch, and I'll highlight that in a minute. If you think you know what the catch is, sound off in the comments below. And while you're there, hit that subscribe button and the bell icon so you don't miss our future videos. Now, having a high specific heat capacity is both good and bad for thermal energy storage. It's good because it means we can increase the temperature a lot with a little heat. This is where it gets a little bit interesting, because sand's thermal conductivity isn't very great. And I thought that might be a bad thing because it limits how fast we can put heat and take heat out. But it turns out there's more to it. I found out that there's problems with thermal energy storage systems as they lose heat through the walls. But since sand conducts heat very slowly, it takes a long time for heat to go from the battery's core to the walls, which reduces energy losses and makes the battery more efficient. More importantly, sand can withstand temperatures of up to 1,000 degrees Celsius, sometimes higher, depending on the type of sand. You can't heat water over 212 degrees Fahrenheit or 100 degrees Celsius without pressurizing it because it'll boil. In fact, you can't heat liquid water at all above its critical point of 374 degrees Celsius and 3200 PSI. This helps us increase the overall amount of energy we can store. This also makes the sand battery useful for mainly industrial applications that require high temperatures, like steam reforming or Aduro's chemolytic plastic recycling technology that we covered in a recent video. Also, when heat from storage is used to generate electricity via steam turbines, higher temperatures improve turbine efficiency. This means more electricity output for the same amount of stored heat. Finally, sand is non-toxic, non-flammable, and as long as you clean it and it doesn't have organic debris in it, poses little environmental risk and doesn't degrade or change its chemical composition even after cycle of heating and cooling. What's not to love? In engineering, there's always a drawback or a catch, right? So what is it here? Otherwise, I mean, sand batteries would be everywhere. Sand batteries have their challenges. For one, their round-trip efficiency, that is the amount of energy you put in that you can get back out, drops pretty significantly. Polar Knight claims their 8 megawatt-hour battery has a round-trip efficiency, or RTE, of up to 95%. That's better than lithium-ion batteries, which fall in the range of around 80 to 90%. But that's for residential heating. What if you want to use a sand battery for your home's electricity? The best you'll be able to pull with a cutting-edge combined cycle power plant is around 65%. So it doesn't really make any sense at all. Something that really scared me was the risk involved. Yes, sand isn't flammable or toxic or yada, 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 but a giant insulated thermos full of white hot sand can still be dangerous. You don't want water around a hot sand battery at all because it's a ticking time bomb, since the water will nearly instantaneously boil and increase in pressure. These systems are obviously designed with safety in mind. What if there was an earthquake or the walls crack? accidents do happen. Sand batteries are big, the bigger the better, since mass and capacity scale faster than the losses on the surface. This makes large batteries very efficient, but small units like ones for a home, like maybe one I could buy, not so much. Remember that, yes, sand is cheap, but you still need heat pumps and radiators and electrical coils to heat and cool and everything else. The unit itself is not going to be particularly cheap, especially as lithium ion prices keep dropping on things like Tesla Powerwalls or Mar Franklin home batteries that we have here. And again, the space is going to be massive. These lithium ion batteries can just hang on a wall right outside your garage, but you'll need a gigantic cylinder for the heat battery. And don't forget that all it could do really is take care of the heating for water and your house. What happens in the summertime when you don't need heat? Possibly not all that valuable. And that's really what it comes down to, is we are competing with a really mature technology in lithium ion batteries. And ultimately, it would only really make sense depending on your use case, maybe really cold climates, maybe in Canada, parts of Northern Europe where it gets really cold, and cold is the driving factor. So while sand batteries probably aren't going to take off for residential use for the reasons I mentioned, where they really shine is at the grid scale. Remember that sand batteries scale really well. They get better and more efficient as they get bigger. And one company is taking these batteries to new heights by building the world's largest sand battery. Polar Night Energy recently secured $8.2 million in funding for a large-scale sand battery in Finland. The new battery will have an output capacity of 1 megawatt. It'll store 100 megawatts of thermal energy, so it'll be over 10 times larger than their first pilot plant from 2022. Their new battery will be able to provide heating for an entire town of 5,000 people for a full week during the coldest winter. This news is right out of the oven, but the battery is tested and ready to be rolled out by mid-2025. But again, these technologies don't exist in a vacuum. A sand battery, even at the commercial scale, will still have to compete with lithium-ion batteries. So how do they fare? Well, to really see, we'd have to compare it to two of the world's largest energy storage facilities, the Edwards and Sanborn Solar Plus Storage Project in California and the Moss Landing Energy Storage Facility. The Edwards and Sanborn Project stores around 3,200 megawatt hours of energy and can output around 875 megawatts of power. And it's made of 110,000 lithium-ion batteries with around 30 kilowatt hours of energy storage each. This system was expensive. At an average of $150 per kilowatt hour of lithium-ion batteries, the facility cost around $500 million, or half the total cost of the project. How does that compare to the larger sand battery? At a cost of $8.2 million for 100 megawatt hours, the sand battery cost of storage is around $82 per kilowatt hour. But that's including testing and development cost as well. The final commercial version will be much cheaper and require much less maintenance. How about size? Here's an image of it on Google. And when we factor in both the largest and second largest lithium-ion battery storage facilities in the world, here's what it breaks down to. Around 100 to 300 megawatt hours per acre for lithium-ion batteries. The Polar Night Sand battery, standing 43 feet tall and 49 feet wide, can store about 2,300 megawatt hours per acre. That's 10 times more energy in the same space. That totally caught me by surprise. But again, a big silo that you can build upward is a great benefit for the sand battery and one that the lithium-ion battery doesn't have. And if you're wondering why can't you just build lithium-ion batteries upward, well, you gotta cool them. You don't want a runaway fire or any other kind of event to then cascade upward. So these batteries are typically well-controlled and separated in the interest of safety. Actually, you know what? I just had a thought. We've been thinking about sand batteries as storing heat, but it could just as easily store cold or the absence of heat. Think about it like this. What if we pumped heat out of the battery and cooled it off during the day? And then in the summertime, when it was really hot in our houses, we could pump that heat from our house into the battery and then cool it again at night when there's excess energy. Heat and thermodynamics are freaking fascinating. It's one of the most fundamental forms of energy and one that's not really fully understood. But just remember that heating in the wintertime, especially in colder parts of the world, is one of the last bastions where many people believe we need natural gas. And if we could do something like this with district heating, imagine the benefit. And now that I've thought about a cold battery in the San Diego summers, I don't know, maybe I'll dig a trench and try it out. But what do you guys think? How does this technology stack up? And is this a big deal? I love follow-up videos because a company that we talked about 2 years ago is actually getting it done. How awesome is that? The next scale, the next chapter, they're doing it. And this might very well be a common sight throughout Northern Europe in the coming years. All right, if you thought that was cool, check out this video next. Until next week, I'm Rigotribo da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.